Human being is capable of a variety of motions. In daily living activities, we use only a small portion of this human capability. However, during sporting activities, we perform and use a large number of human capabilities, and sometimes we try to cross the limits of human performance. These activities are performed normally using the skeletal system, and this skeletal system is moved by the skeletal muscles. We need to understand how this skeleton moves with the help of muscles so that we can change the activities and actually design the training schedule. In this module, we will focus on the learning of macrostructure, that is the connection between skeletal system and muscles, the attachments, origin, insertion, those aspects. Secondly, we will try to learn about the muscle bundle itself, how the muscle cells are organized in a particular muscle bundle, that is known as pinnation. Thirdly, we will try to learn about the muscle contraction mechanism by which the actually muscle shortens and lengthens. Human activity depends on holding or movement of axial structure and appendicular structure. By axial structure, we include vertebral column, skull, ribs, and sternum. Appendicular structure includes the upper extremities and lower extremities. Look here, there is a movement of elbow in the screen. There are two muscles, one is biceps and another is triceps. The flexion of the elbow is going on. After the flexion, there is extension of the elbow. So during flexion, the biceps muscle is bulging out, and during extension, the triceps muscle is bulging out. So essentially, the movements are made by contraction and relaxation of the muscles. The same picture, we have stopped it. You can see in the shortened condition, the biceps is bulged or it is in contracted state, and the triceps is bulged during the relaxed state. So in these two pictures, it is very, very clear. So we have learned that the muscles are actually helping the motion by contracting and relaxing. However, this contraction and relaxation will make certain movements according to the attachment of the muscles with the bones and the line of pull. All the muscles has got a point of origin and a point of insertion. Some muscles has point of origin with tendon, and some muscles has with bone. In this picture, you can see there is the origin and insertion of two sections of the muscle belly of the biceps muscle. In the origin part, there are two sections independently, and during insertion, they combine together and insert in a common tendon in radius. The portion between origin and starting of tendon is called muscle belly. As I was telling you earlier, the muscles originate either from tendon or in the bone directly. But obviously, it has to end in the bone through a tendon or some kind of tendinous structure, which is generally called as aponeurosis. Some muscles does not origin from bone. For example, the muscles of the lips, it is a circular type of muscle. The name of the muscle is orbicularis oris, and this muscle actually helps our speech. When we talk, this muscle makes the lip movement. This particular orbicularis muscle, it origin from other muscles. You can see the picture here, how it hangs on the space. In the intact human body, the muscle belly is slightly bulged, and this bulging gives characteristic shape of the body. If the muscle bulk is more, then the bulging is more, like in bodybuilders. However, this bulging increases during muscle contraction. Here in this picture, you can see that the elbow has been flexed and the biceps muscle has bulged out. When the person has stretched his arm to maximum, then the bulging is almost gone. So this is the characteristics we can see. Let us have a look in tendons. The tendons are actually fibrous tissue. They are collagen, and it has got different shapes. It can be round, rope-like structure, or it can be flat. And sometimes the tendons are flat and broad. In those cases, it is called aponeurosis. Aponeurosis in the lumbar region of the body, in the backside, there is a big size of aponeurosis, and that is called lumbar aponeurosis. From this aponeurosis, the muscles like latissimus dorsi, erector spinae, they originate. In the human body, when we carry weights, for example, if I carry weight in the arm, then the weight will be carried by the structures that are known as ligaments. Ligaments are actually connective tissues that join one bone to another bone. These ligaments are very, very strong and tough structures. There are certain ligaments on which the whole body can be hanged, so it can carry a weight of around 100 kilogram. As we carry the loads on hand, the maximum pressure, the maximum force is borne by the ligaments of the shoulder. You can see here some of the ligaments in the shoulder joint, like clavicle attaching with the scapula and the humerus attaching to the scapula. All these ligaments cover the portion of the joint and make movements possible along with the weight bearing. In the joints, there are other structures also. You can see here the part known as bursa. These bursa lie under the belly of the ligaments or tendons, and they reduce the frictional force between the bone and the ligament so that the ligament does not tear off. There are many bursa like structures in all the joints, and these bursa sometimes can be infected, which can cause to bursitis. They are very, very painful if it happens under the feet, especially in sports persons it is very common. So far we have learnt about the muscle attachment with the bone. Let us have a look in the nature of arrangement of the muscle fibers along with the tendons. This is known as the muscle architecture. How the muscle fibers are arranged around the tendons, or how it creates an axis with the bone. This axis is important because the line of pull will be determined by this axis. So the structural arrangement, architectural arrangement of the muscle fibers is very, very important, since it will be causing a particular line of pull, and actually it will make the motion. There are two types of muscle architecture. One is parallel type, another is pinnate type. Sometimes pinnate is uttered as pinnate. In parallel type, there are subclasses like strap muscles, fusiform muscles, and convergent muscles. In pinnate type of arrangement, there is unipinnate, multipinnate, and bipinnate. Here I have shown some of the examples of parallel arrangement of the muscle fibers. You can see the strap muscle. One great example is sternocleidomastoid muscle of the neck. This muscle causes neck motion in the side direction. Biceps is the best example of fusiform muscle. And a convergent muscle example is pectoralis major. It looks like a fan, as if a fan handle is the humerus and it is spreading to the chest. In pinnison type, there is unipinnate muscle. The example is extensor digitorum longus of the leg. Bipinnate muscle is rectus femoris. Multipinnate muscle, you can see here deltoid muscle is a multipinnate muscle, because in deltoid there are three parts. One is anterior deltoid, another is posterior deltoid, and the middle deltoid. In all these three, the direction of muscle has got difference, and that is why it is called multipinnate muscle. In rectus femoris muscle, you can see there is a cleft-like structure in the middle of the rectus femoris muscle, and the fibers are arranged in both directions. So it actually creates a sidewise pull. Next, let us come to the blood supply. Muscles look red because it is abundantly supplied by blood. It is normally seen that the blood supply has two types of arrangement. One is a square type of arrangement, another is hexagonal arrangement. In square type of capillary arrangement has a fiber ratio of 1:1 and sharing factor is 4:1. One particular muscle fiber is surrounded by four capillaries, so the sharing factor is 4:1, four capillaries to supply one muscle fiber. And the architecture, if we combine all the muscle fibers, it looks like this. In hexagonal arrangement, the capillary ratio is again 1:1. However, there is a sharing factor of 3:1 only. In the hexagonal arrangement is three blood vessels with one fiber. So actually, in hexagonal arrangement, the blood supply is lesser than the square arrangement. With training, the muscle fiber and capillary ratio changes. Let us come to microstructure of the muscles. You can see in this picture a muscle originating from a bone through tendon, and we have cut it in between. You can see there are surrounded structures which can be called as fasces, or sometimes it is called fascicle. The outer side of the muscle is covered by perimysium, and then each muscle fiber is covered by endomysium, and finally all the muscle bundles are covered by epimysium. Single muscle fibers are covered by endomysium, muscle bundles are covered by perimysium, and a number of bundles are covered by epimysium. So this is the arrangement normally happens, and in these bundles, each bundle may contain some type of muscle fiber, or sometimes it may be mixed also. When you look at the muscles under large magnification, especially if we look under the electron microscope in low magnifications like 200 times, then we will see some band like structure. One band to another band is called a sarcomere, and within the sarcomere there are bands like A band, and another part is there that is known as I band. In between A band there is Z band, and two sarcomeres are connected by a Z disc. This was the earliest observation. After that, there are so many research studies, and finally, a shape like this picture has been evolved. In this picture, you can see thick filament in the middle of the structure and thin filament attached with the Z line. These thick filaments are hung by a protein molecule which is known as titin, and the Z band is holding the thin filament. Middle of the thick filament, a line passes through which is known as M line. The thick filament is made of myosin molecule or myosin protein. Thin filament is made of actin, tropomyosin and troponin. Detailed structure of the myosin looks like this. There are two heads and one tail. Tail is a spiral like structure. These two heads normally attach to the actin filament during contraction. The thick filament looks like the picture shown in the right side of the slide. It is a bare zone where there is no head and this bad zone, multiple myosin molecules are arranged sequentially to create the thick filament. And the picture in the right side, you can see that the heads are arranged and there is a portion where no myosin head is available. This portion is known as bare zone. Bare zone is important because the actin molecule should not go overlapping. The thin filament has got three components, as I have told earlier. It is actin filament, they are ball-like structures. Then these actin filaments are held by tropomyosin molecule, which is a tape-like structure or thread-like structure. And there is troponin molecule. All these three are twisted and it looks like a necklace. Finally, it creates the thin filament. So far, we have talked about the muscle structure in the gross arrangements, attachment with the bones, and the microstructure. Now we will talk of the muscle contraction, theories of muscle contraction. Many theories came up from the time of around 1900 or 1902 when Professor A.B. Hill was working on muscle. But ultimately, sliding filament theory has received wide acceptance. In 1954, two independent papers came on sliding filament theory or sliding filament model of muscle contraction. The authors were H.E. Huxley and J. Henson, and in another group, the author were A.F. Huxley and R. Niederg. The sliding filament theory is the most accepted theories of muscle contraction till date, since it can explain majority of the actions in detail. The sliding filament theory explains the contraction process. However, before the contraction happens, the electrical impulse has to come to the muscle. So there are five stages before actually the contraction of muscle starts. In the first phase, nerve impulse arrives at the neuromuscular junction. The moment nerve impulse arrives at the neuromuscular junction, a compound known as acetylcholine is released into the gap between axon and motor end plate. Then this acetylcholine binds at the active site of the muscle membrane. This binding causes depolarization at the site of muscle cell, and this depolarization travels throughout the muscle fiber. This traveling of depolarization wave causes the muscle contraction. You can see here three pictures. One is muscle as seen in the resting state, showing the actin filament or thin filament and thick filament both. In the left side, when muscle fiber is contracted, it is shown. You can see and compare the change in the width of the muscle. In the right side, we have shown the stretched condition of the muscle, and muscle has stretched to maximum possible limit. If it goes beyond that, then the titin fibers can tear off. Let us have a look in the details of the sliding filament theory. It is only four stages, the actual contraction process. At the starting point of the contraction, the myosin head is not attached to the actin. It is lying low, and one ATP is attached to the myosin head. In the second stage, the ATP breaks down to ADP and energy, and that energy causes the motion of the myosin head. At the same time, calcium ion that is released by the passing of electrical impulse that binds on the troponin molecule, and the troponin molecule pulls the tropomyosin thread little upward to expose the active site of the actin molecule. And once the active site is open, then the myosin head can go and attach to the active site. In the third stage, the myosin heads go and attach to the active site of the actin molecule, and then it causes a inward motion which pulls the thin filament to the inside of the muscle fiber. That means towards the M line. And this pull of the myosin head is known as the power stroke. Actin and myosin attachment thus happening is released only after another ATP arrives and replaces the ADP that is still on the myosin head. If there is shortage of ATP, then the myosin head will not be released and the muscle will remain contracted. This is what happens after death. Since the man is dead, the new ATPs are not being manufactured and the fresh supply of ATP is not available. It remains attached, and which makes the muscle very stiff. The whole body becomes stiff, and it is called medically as rigor mortis. Now have a look at the contraction process. See the sliding motion of the fibers. The thin filaments, come closer to the M line during contraction, and during relaxation the thin filaments go away from the M line, and this is the gross motion. Let us have a look at the level of titin and what happens when titin is overstretched. See at the molecular level what happens. As I was telling earlier, you can see the animation of the movement. See it again. I hope with this picture you have got a clear idea of the muscle contraction. Let us have a look at the muscle actions at the surface level, means intact human body level. The joints are mobile, so joints can change angles, and when the angle changes towards 0 degree, that means from a bigger angle to the smaller angle, when it comes towards that side, it is called flexion. And when the angle increases from 0 to the bigger side, it is called extension. Muscles can contract, it can pull, but relaxation is a passive process. So remember always this, because you have to understand motions, how it happens. Let us look at the biceps. Biceps causes elbow flexion by pulling the radius and ulna bone, and triceps at that time, at that particular contraction time of bicep muscle, triceps muscle gets stretched or relaxed, you can say. It reverses when the elbow gets extended during extension. The elbow muscles during extension, the triceps muscle pulls the elbow outward, so the angle of the joint increases. At that time biceps is stretched. So essentially the motion was done by pull, not by push. So muscles can only pull. See the example here, and if we look at the joint arrangement of the human body, then when we push something, then pushing action comes by a combination of contraction and relaxation of different muscles, not one single muscle. Only a pull can happen by a single muscle, but when we combine many muscles, some muscles are pulling, some muscles are getting stretched, and a combination of muscle contraction and relaxation happen, and thus we can create a pushing action. Muscle contractions according to the joint angles are classified in two categories. One is static contraction, another is dynamic contraction. Static contractions are also called as isometric contraction. For example, if when you grip something and keep it holding, then the muscles have already acted. It has gripped the thing, but it remains in the contraction stage. So it is an isometric action. And in dynamic action, there are two classifications mainly, but some authors say third category. These three categories are concentric contraction, eccentric contraction, and isokinetic contraction. Isokinetic contractions are not normal contractions, or naturally it is not possible to create. It can be created by machines which are known as isokinetic machine. The basic concept of isokinetic motion is that the joint has to move in same velocity. Same velocity cannot happen naturally because the gravitational forces will change with the contraction process, and the weight of the particular component that is being moved will change. So naturally, even if it goes in the same velocity, the motion will not be remaining in the same velocity. So mv will change. So since the mv changes, it cannot be called as isokinetic. So it can be created only in a machine, isokinetic machine. Isokinetic machines are very helpful in rehabilitation process of the muscle injuries. Static contraction, you can see an example as holding the knee straight. We maintain most of the postures or static postures for human poses. Pose means how he is holding the body. That depends on the contraction process, that is isometric contraction process. You can see the knee is being kept straight by the contraction of muscles, rectus femoris, vastus medialis, and vastus lateralis. Look at this film. This is concentric contraction. Look at the film again. It is a concentric contraction. See the eccentric contraction. See again. Look at the bulging reduction of the biceps muscle and increase in the triceps muscle bulging. See again the change in the bulging nature. See further explanation about the isokinetic contraction. We have come to the end of the lecture on muscle contraction. Next lecture will be on transmission of nerve impulse.